Hello, everybody. This morning I am at, first of all, I'm freezing. I'm at the White River Narrows Archaeological District within the Basin and Range National Monument. And yes, that was a mouthful. And yes, I did have to practice that in the car several times. But looks like on take 40, I finally spit it out, and which is great because I'm running out of memory and batteries. So we're good to go to keep moving forward on this little project. So as you can probably see behind me, we have this amazing petroglyph panel. So this is going to be the subject of my photo for today. Before I talk about the how, why, when, where, of this, I kind of want to talk about the site. So if anybody wants to come visit, at least you'll have a little bit of useful information. So one, this is one of five archaeological districts within the park boundaries. Even though this one is probably the closest to the highway, I would not say it's the easiest one to get to. The main reason why is, as you probably saw in the little montage of me driving into the park on how dusty it was, this entire canyon is volcanic rock, specifically volcanic ash. They got deposited on a long ago eruption, got buried, heat, pressure, all that fun stuff, turned it to a rock, fault lines, uplift, started eroding away, decomposition, oxidation, all that fun science stuff. And the entire canyon floor is covered in a material that basically is a consistency of like talcum powder. And when it's raining, definitely do not come here because it does not drain very well. And the water just sits on top from my little experiment I did out in the parking lot. And also the BLM requires or recommends a high clearance 4x4. So this is one time that I would have to agree that you would absolutely have to have a high clearance 4x4 with decent tires. I'm running BFG all-terrains KO2s, and they handle fine. So do not come here in your little Honda Civic because you will get stuck. And there's no cell phone reception. This particular spot during the week, pretty much other than Saturday, is not very well visited. Yes, as you can probably hear, there's a major highway to about 500 yards to the left of me. So you might be able to flag somebody down if you're in trouble, but don't count on it. So just be smart as you're driving through. There's really deep ruts. I know in my video you kind of showed me, driving through the ruts. That was more for video effect and having some fun. But if you're just running regular street tires and stuff, just stay out of the ruts and don't make new trails. Stay on the trail that you're on. And if you don't feel like your vehicle can make it through certain spots, then at that point, call it good, turn around, and so that way you can just be on with the rest of your day. This trail really is only like 2 miles, so you can just hike in. That's an option too. All right, so second thing is this is a fairly new national monument, and it was created in 2015. So because of that, there's no visitor center, no bathrooms, no paved roads, except for the two main highways that bisect the park. And there's basically no infrastructure here. So please make sure that you pack everything in, bring all your food, water, snacks, everything. But more importantly, please pack everything out. Take your beer bottles and your cigarette butts with you. We don't need to be leaving them here in the park. The third and probably most important is that this is rattlesnake country, Great Basin rattlers, and if you bring your dog, kids with you, make sure you keep an eye on them because, as you, I don't know if you can tell behind me, but this is fairly tall grass, and snakes love hiding in tall grass and rock outcroppings and stuff. So definitely where Caliente is probably the closest clinic, and that's 45 minutes to an hour away. So just remind yourself, you're, even though you're not technically in the middle of nowhere, but you are, and help can be a minute to get to you. So be smart and, you know, don't do anything stupid. So with that being said, enough of all the OSHA safety talk. We want to talk about panels. So let's go ahead and take a quick look. Actually, I'm going to start at one end because there's actually one panel that to me is probably the most interesting, even though it's not the most photogenic. So let's head on over there. So this is probably my favorite panel, or I should say panels, because these are actually two separate rocks. And on the right is Fremont. And Fremont, you can usually tell because the anthropomorphs are very, you have these trapezoid shapes to them, very angular. And also you'll see the headdresses. Sometimes they're old jewelry, like necklaces, earrings, very ceremonial in their appearance. And what I love about this panel, so I've been to quite a few archaeological sites and I've seen lots of rock art. This is the only place that I've been to that actually can see there's pigment inside of the rock carving. So haven't been to like every single site out there, but I've been to quite a few, and I've only seen that here. So I don't exactly know how rare that is. I don't know if that was actually a common thing when these were created and the pigments eventually just washed out. I don't really know. Try to find the answer to that, and unfortunately I wasn't able to find much info. But I just find that really interesting that there's paint inside. On the left is, they call it the Great Basin style, but I really couldn't find exactly who did it. So I just had to take an educated guess because of the exaggerated extremities, big hands, big feet. This is probably Ute. And to be honest, I'm not even going to guess what exactly this is. Since this is going on the internet, I will leave that up to you. You come to your own conclusions on what you think they're trying to portray in that particular carving. But nevertheless, there's actually pigment inside these as well. It's actually quite a bit on this one. And I think probably out of the three figures, the most interesting is this one, because the eyes are actually carved out. So it gives it a really, really alien look to it. And honestly, I just think that just looks cool. So very reminiscent of the pictographs you see like in Seago Canyon. Very alien-like. And yeah. And of course, you have the squiggly lines and all the pecs and dots, circles. So very ceremonial for these two panels. Now, we'll just head over. And of course, this goes all the way around. Has some really cool lichen. Not really, I can't really make out these down here at the bottom. I don't really see any zoomorphs or any other human-like figures. Some more down over here. Some really cool lichen on these rocks. Lots of tumbleweeds. And of course, we're back to our main panel. And there's actually, the panels go way over here and pretty much all along the bottom of this canyon. So but right here is the subject. So let me go ahead and get set up and we'll talk about this one. All right, so I'm back at the main panel and pretty much all set up and ready to go. So first off, I'm actually standing behind the camera as I'm filming this. Main reason why is this is like a 250-foot cliff face, and let me pan up. I mean, that's pretty tall. So actually, I'm getting a lot of reverb, so my voice is bouncing back to me as I've been talking. And also the wind is picking up, so I have my back to the wind. So needless to say, we got some audio stuff to deal with, so I'm doing what I can. And if the audio is a little bit funky, you know, I do apologize for that. So why this image? Why this spot? And what exactly am I trying to say here, you know, with taking this photo? This is actually my fifth visit, my fifth and hopefully final visit, because I think I have it figured out by now. Trying to answer that question. So when I was here the first time, it was actually my first visit to this particular spot. And like most people, you know, I saw the petroglyphs and thought, hey, no, that's pretty cool. There's no placards. There's really no information. There's really not a lot of data for me to, you know, look at. So the trailhead does have a pamphlet, but it doesn't really give me the information that I'm looking for. So I went through and I just took a bunch of pictures, a bunch of snapshots, just to kind of just so that way later I can review and see if, you know, there's anything there. Got home, looked at the photos, and just didn't really see anything, you know, that was what I would consider remarkable, or nothing that just stood out. But I kind of knew that there's something here, I just didn't quite know what. So I came out a second time and decided to actually focus on these two panels. The main reason why is I think this one and the one next to it, which I'll swing over. So there's a small one right here. These two are probably the most photogenic of all the petroglyphs here, because for one thing, you do see the zoomorphs, you do see bighorn sheep, you do see some anthropomorphs, so human-like figures. You do see, you know, some very familiar shapes that are little more than just squiggly lines and all that. So that would be something that would be necessary for me to try to help tell the story. So I kept working these and went home, looked at the photos, and again, they just weren't all that remarkable. They were mediocre at best. So decided I'm gonna come out a third time to start working on, because all the photos I've been taking have been pretty much just head on. And I was thinking to myself, well, maybe I just need to pick a different angle, you know, or something. But it's really hard because you have these 250-foot vertical cliffs. I mean, it's really hard to try to find a different composition. But I knew there was something here. I just couldn't see it. And on my third visit was when everything kind of changed. So when I pulled up, I saw a gentleman like painting the rocks. And I kind of knew what he was doing, but I wasn't quite sure because, you know, the parking lot's, you know, a good 125 yards from where I'm standing right now. So as I walked up, and you know, my guess was right, he was a contractor contracted by the Bureau of Land Management to do graffiti removal. And you know, we talked because he was out here by himself. And apparently, like, I showed up like 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and I was like the first person that showed up that day. So, and we talked for at least a good hour and a half, 2 hours, and the wealth of knowledge that man has, that he passed on to me, was so far above and beyond anything I could have read on the book, on a blog post, website, or even in a pamphlet. So he gave me some information that completely changed my perspective of this particular shot. So it didn't really change how I'm going to shoot it, so I'm still going to shoot straight on. But at least now I have a story and a processing method to be able to now tell that story. So in this scene, there's actually three things going on. Obviously, you have the petroglyph, right? So this is an entire band that runs from left to right. So that whole panel is going to be in the shot. Now, the two other things. So that cow patty right there should be a clue as to what's next. So if you notice on the rock, there's a bathtub ring all along the bottom. When I first saw that, I was under the conclusion that because these are vertical cliffs, rainwater would wash down the cliff face, hit the ground, and splash up and eroded the rock away. You know, I've seen it before, you know, like my own house has a stucco finish on the outside, so I don't have rain gutters, and when it rains, there's actually staining and stuff all along the bottom edge from all the water and dirt and stuff being splashed up. So I just drew that conclusion, and I was wrong. Shouldn't be a surprise. I didn't think it was illogical, but it just wasn't correct for this particular spot. So after talking to that gentleman, and I mentioned the cow patty, so even to this day, going back decades, cattle grazing has been going on here. And what's been happening is cattle would lean up against or stand right up against the wall and urinate on the walls. So all the salt and the minerals and stuff that's in the urine has basically bleached out the rock. And once he said that, that changed everything, because now I have a story to put together, right? Here you have a petroglyph panel of ancient peoples trying to document their understanding of the world around them. They're talking about their spirituality. They're talking about their relationship with the earth. They're talking about their relationship with each other. Game animals, you know, game trails. They're just trying to figure it out. And, you know, they were hunter-gatherers. So anything that they could do to try to make life a little bit easier for them by just taking notes and putting the notes on the walls, you know, that's what they did. And here you have, you know, modern progress basically erasing our history. And once I made that connection in my head, again, that changed everything. Because there we go, that's my story. And now, of course, there's the third thing, is that the gentleman who I was talking to doing the graffiti removal, if you see those discolored spots, like right here and right here, that was a graffiti. So basically, you have three things. You have the petroglyphs, you have modern progress erasing it, and then you have our attempts to try and conserve it. And there was the photo. That was it. So I knew it was something there. I just was missing some information to connect all the dots. So the next thing, of course, is how am I going to shoot this? You know, the first few test shots, honestly, didn't quite come out all that great. They're, in my opinion, again, mediocre at best. So in photography, when you're trying to narrow a viewer's focus down to exactly where you want them to look to be able to, so you can, they can understand the story that you're trying to tell, you know, there's techniques like using leading lines or framing your subject or things like that. One technique that I like to use is basically removing information and get rid of things that honestly aren't useful to the photo. So for this instance, we're getting rid of the color. So we're going to shoot this in black and white. Main reason why, I mean, if you look at like the grass here, you know, it's a pale, it's all dead grass, very pale, you know, yellow. You have all the, you know, all the earth tones in the rock. Sure, there's some with the desert varnish, there's some variations and stuff, but nothing really that, you know, is really standing out. So once you get rid of the color, now you're going to narrow the viewer's focus down to just the textures and the tones. Color is no longer in the picture. So get rid of the color. The petroglyphs, for one thing, they're going to pop because, as you can tell, I mean, they're, I wouldn't say they're getting lost in the image, but because of the color of the rock, they're, you know, they don't stand out as well as I would want them to be. So black and white, they really pop. So shoot in black and white. And that will now narrow the focus of attention down to exactly what you want them to look at. Now, to be fair, some people might say, well, you know, if you have to explain a picture, is it really a good photo? And, you know, when I first came to the scene, that story wasn't obvious to me at upon first glance. So if that's the case to me, then it may not necessarily be the case to another person. So I think that's where, you know, you're going to have to be creative. I think this may not necessarily be a wall hanger, but I think it might do very well inside of a book, or maybe in a social media post, or maybe, you know, in a forum. It's like, hey, I saw this really cool place. And so, I mean, really, you know, as I am out searching for stories, you know, I all I want to do is just kind of show people, hey, here's a really cool place, and it deserves to be protected, and it deserves to be respected. And, you know, I mean, gosh, I would really love for a fence to be put up so the cattle won't get near this artwork. So hopefully, you know, hopefully something good would come from this. And, you know, for me, photography is more than just taking a pretty picture. I think if there's some education and knowledge behind it, I think that's even better. Not to say there's anything wrong with a pretty picture, but, you know, lately I've been wanting to take photos that has a little more weight to it, and I think this is one of them. So we're going to go ahead and, for taking the photo, nothing really special because, again, I mean, look at how flat the light is. You definitely don't want to be taking this in direct sunlight because the sunlight's going to wash everything out and you're not going to be able to see it. We're in the shade. Shade is a perfect situation to be shooting this in. And, no bracketing, nothing. Just single shots and, you know, I'm roughly about f11 because that's going to be the roughly the sharpest range on my lens. I'm using a 24-70 on my D810. So, but other than that, you know, that's really about it. So I know I've been talking a lot. So, and I'm actually about ready to run out of memory cards. So I really hope that you, you know, you like this. Really hope you like this video. I'm really trying my best to up the video production and try to make this a little bit less like a vlog and more like, oh, I don't know. Honestly, I really don't know. But hopefully you found it entertaining. Hopefully you found it informative. If you have any comments, questions, concerns, feel free to leave them down in the comments section. If you're feeling what I'm putting out, feel free to subscribe and ring that notification button. And once I'm done talking, you should see a photo popping up with some fancy music. So thank you for watching, and we'll see you on the next one.